Good morning. Good morning. Just as we continue to gather this morning, we're going to join together to sing this lovely version of Psalm 103. So just as we remain in our seats, we will sing, "Bless the Lord, O my soul."
Good morning, everybody. It's great to see you all out this morning, and lovely, dare I say, to have you all packed in downstairs. There's something special about everybody being closer together, and certainly from my point of view as a preacher, the fact I'm not flipping up and down, that you're all just here, makes life a whole lot easier and much more engaging. But you're all very welcome, very special welcome to any visitors we have today. We have quite a few. It's good to see you on this special service, and we will you'll find out shortly why we have so many visitors with us, but I trust you're blessed by your time here amongst us this morning. And a good warm welcome to all at home, whether you're watching live or watching DVD during the week. Again, we trust that you will know the blessing of God as you worship with us and listen to his word being proclaimed. Number of announcements. One that isn't on it is tomorrow night, anybody who is free, grass cutting at 7. It's that time to get round the graveyard again. The grass is rocketing up. So if you're free tomorrow night with your strimmers and mowers, please come along at 7. And just like last time, the more that are here, the quicker it is done on your way home again. So please come along if you're available. Wednesday, we have our prayer time at 8 o'clock over in the park room. And then Thursday, ladies, women's Bible study at 2:30 in the park room again. And then next Sunday, normal morning activities, and then a 6:30 evening worship, and the children's club jam will be on as well. And then on the rear side of it is we advert for the coffee morning up at the manse in a couple of weeks' time, from 10:30 to 12:30, and any proceeds from that coffee morning will be going to the rebuilding of the church hall. You can see it's flying. The bricklayers are really making great progress, and the forecast is good this week weather-wise, so they should really rattle on with the work. So this is the point now. Poor John's getting bills every month and having to write scary amounts of checks. It's frightening. So the money's going out, but we need a wee bit more to come in. So coffee morning at the manse, and it's just an opportunity to join with each other and to have a bit of chat, and also to give towards the building of our new hall. There was a wee question because the advert or the announcement last week said coffee morning and gift day. Somebody saying they're going to be gifts. No, they're not going to be gifts. The gift day is you giving. The gift day is you giving. So if you can give a fiver, 50, 500, 5,000, 50, well, you know what I mean. Whatever you can give, whatever the Lord is, however the Lord has blessed you, and you can return bless the work of his church here in First Bershane. But come along, please, the 3rd of June. Bring friends along as well with you, and just make it a wonderful day. But we're here to worship. We're here to worship a wonderful God. Church of Ireland in particular among you, what was last Thursday, if you know your church calendar? Junior Church of Ireland, you've forgotten? Thursday was Ascension Day. Today in the church marks the return of Christ after his resurrection to sit at his Father's right hand in glory. There he is crowned with many crowns. There he is worshipped as the King of all. And so we are going to do that this morning. We are going to sing this hybrid version of an old hymn, Crown Him with Many Crowns. He is the Majesty, Lord of all. Let's raise our voices to our great and mighty Lord and King.
Cry.
Let's pray. And as we bow in prayer and think about the words that we have just been singing, words that really just jump out of Scripture, jump out of the book of Revelation when the Apostle John was given that privileged vision of the heavenly courts. And the Lamb was upon the throne, and the heavenly beings and all the saints were gathered around. And they were raising their voices and they were praising God. And John penned these words, "I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea and all that is in them saying, to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever. And the four living creatures said, Amen. And the elders fell down and worshipped." Well, what a picture. What an image of what is going on in the heavenly courts right now. Your name is being praised, where you are being lifted high, where they're crying out, "All hail, King Jesus. All hail, Redeemer, hail." Their hearts are filled with joy and being in your presence. Our mouths are overflowing with the praise because you, O Lord, you're the one who died upon that tree. You're the one who died with our names written in your hands to rescue us, to set us free from a lost eternity. And Father, to know the joy of your salvation and to bow before you as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Father, we are filled with hope because you did not stay dead, but you triumphed over the grave and you rose victorious, Lord, to rescue those that you have called to be your own. And follow me, if we can remember what you have done, if we can remember that wonderful victory, Lord, how can we not bow before you and give our all to you? Because there is no earthly ruler has ever laid down his life and took it up again. You're the only one who can do that. And therefore, you are the King of Kings. You are greater than all. And the only one who is worthy of praise and honor and glory. The only one who is worthy to receive our worship. Father, as we gather this morning, and particularly this morning, Lord, as we take time later on to remember Calvary, to remember the sacrifice, to remember the depths of your love and your grace that you poured out upon a guilty people. Father, may your praise be loud on our lips. May we indeed be joining with those in heaven who are saying, "Worthy is the Lamb to receive all glory, honor, and praise." May we cry out, "All hail, Redeemer, hail!" Not just as we're sitting here in this building and singing your praise, but when we go out there, Lord, we will be lifting high your name. We will be declaring you as the one true God and only Savior and hope of this world. And Father, that your praise, your honor, and your glory, Father, will not fail to be evident in our lives. That when people see us, they will see you. And Father, they will bow down and worship and declare you as their Lord, as their King, and give you their lives and give you all the praise. So Father, come among us this morning. Help us to see the Lamb upon the throne. Help us to bow before him and worship him. And we ask us in his name, the name of the Lord Jesus, your only and perfect Son. Amen. Children, you just stay in your seats this morning. I'm going to come down because we're doing something a wee bit different this morning. And this is where some of you are going to find out why we've got so many visitors with us today. One of the last instructions the Lord gave to his disciples was this: all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the end of the age. And ever since then, we have been baptizing people into the Church of Jesus Christ. And as the Presbyterian Church, we believe in infant baptism. We believe there's a very clear teaching throughout Scripture of infant baptism, the baptizing of believers' children. We believe that their children are brought in under the covenant of God. But we also believe in adult baptism, believers' baptism, which many people don't think the Presbyterian Church does. But we do. We believe in baptizing adults who have come to faith and were not baptized as a child. We also practice the biblical pattern of where baptism has to precede coming to the Lord's table. Again, that is a very biblical pattern throughout Scriptures, and that's why this morning we're having a baptismal service. Not of a child, well, she is a child, but she's a big child. Not of a baby, but of an adult on profession of faith before she comes and partakes of the fellowship of the Lord's table. Miss Amy, can you come up, please? You can stand on the carpet. Amy, you have responded to the gospel call to repent of your sin and put your trust in the Lord Jesus Christ as your only Saviour. And you have expressed your desire to confess that faith publicly by this act of baptism. Can I assure you that as you truly profess your faith and are baptized into his name, the sacrament shall be to you the sign and seal of the washing away of your sins, of your engrafting into Christ, and of the new birth by his Holy Spirit. And of course, your response to God through Jesus Christ to walk in obedience in the newness of life. By coming to baptism, I have to ask you some questions. It's good practice for next summer. It's the same answer. Okay. Just listen to the first word of the question and you'll know how to answer it. So firstly, do you believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? I do. And depending on the grace of God, do you trust in Jesus Christ alone as your Saviour from sin and as your Lord of your life?
I do.
And do you promise to live as a follower of a Jesus Christ, led and empowered by the Holy Spirit?
I do.
And do you commit as a baptized member of the church to worship, serve, give, and participate fully in its life and witness?
I do.
Okay. To the congregation, a question, because we make a commitment at this stage as well. As we receive Amy into the fellowship of this church, do you promise to join with her in the life of prayer, worship, and service that we together offer to God? That wasn't bad. Amy, ask you to kneel. Say, there was a young lady said to me this week when she realised this was happening that there's no point in Amy washing your hair this morning because it's going to go frizzy. Amy, I baptise you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. And according to Christ's command, Amy is received into the membership of the one holy, universal, and apostolic church. Please stand. Here you go. May take a seat. Let's just have a prayer for a moment. Father, thank you for this occasion. This occasion in Amy's life and her family's life and in the life of this church family here. This occasion of coming forward for the sacrament of baptism, a sacrament that points to your amazing grace, that reminds us that we have a great need, a need to be washed, a need to be cleansed from our guilt, from our sin, our rebellion against you, our Creator. A sacrament that points us to your grace in that you step down to this filthy, stinking world and suffered immensely to rescue a guilty people, those who had rebelled, those who had put you to death, rejected you. thank you for this wonderful occasion. Lord, thank you for this reminder of our need and how you, a holy God, have met that need. I thank you today. Amy has stood here. She has made that public declaration of the saving faith in Christ. That she has trusted in your grace. She has trusted in your Son's sacrifice. She is leaning upon you and you alone for her salvation. We thank you for her love for you and her desire to serve you in so, so many ways. And Father, we pray that she may continue to grow in the knowledge and in the fear of the Lord. That the joy of your salvation may radiate through her, Lord, in her home and in her job and wherever she may be. And Lord, that she will continue to grow to be a fine young woman who brings honour and praise unto you. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amy, welcome. And we'll be doing more of that later on as well. You know, the sacraments are not about us. What I've just done is ultimately not about Amy. The sacraments, whether it's baptism or the Lord's table, all point us to God, to his grace, and his faithfulness to keep his promises. To put it very, very simply, this is not terribly theological, but anyway, baptism points us, as I said in my prayer, to our need of cleansing, to our need of forgiveness from our sin, from our guilt, which can only be found in faith in Jesus Christ. The Lord's Supper, the bread and the wine are symbols that cause us to remember to cast our minds back to Calvary and the price that was paid for that salvation, for our cleansing. And so on a day when we celebrate both sacraments in the one service, I think it's very appropriate to sing this next song. You chose it. Because it says in the song, all honour and blessing and power belongs to you, Lord Jesus Christ. What we do here today is to point us to Jesus and draw us ever closer to him. We'll remain in our seats to start with, and our offering for God's work will be lifted at this point, and then we'll stand and sing the rest of the hymn, Jesus Shall Take the Highest Honour. And after this, the children can leave for Children's Church. turn with me, please, to Acts chapter 5. We're going to read verses 1 through to 11 this morning. I'm not going to be expounding this passage, but I will be making reference to it later on in the sermon. We're going to read Acts chapter 5, verse 1. This is in very, very early days of the fledgling Christian church. Christ had ascended back to glory. The apostles were going around proclaiming the gospel message that Christ had risen from the dead and was Lord of all, and salvation was found in his name alone and no one else. Peter and John stood before the redeemed, the wonderful truth. And just the end of chapter 4 is a wee bit there, but it's entitled in my Bible, They Had Everything in Common. It speaks of how the early church shared what they had. They shared what they had with those who were in need. Some people sold fields and brought the money to the apostles to help the poor and the needy and whatever work the church was doing. And then we pick up the story in chapter 5 and verse 1, and it says this: But a man named Ananias with his wife Sapphira sold a piece of property, and with his wife's knowledge he kept back for himself some of the proceeds and brought only a part of it and laid it at the apostles' feet. But Peter said to Ananias, Why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Spirit and to keep back for yourself part of the proceeds of the land? While it remained unsold, did it not remain your own? And after it was sold, was it not at your disposal? Why is it that you have contrived this deed in your heart? You have not lied to men, but to God. When Ananias heard these words, he fell down and breathed his last. And great fear came upon all who heard of it. The young men rose and wrapped him up and carried him out and buried him. After an interval of about 3 hours, his wife came in, not knowing what had happened. And Peter said to her, Tell me whether you sold the land for so much. And she said, Yes, for so much. But Peter said to her, How is it that you have agreed together to test the Spirit of the Lord? Behold, the feet of those who have buried your husband are at the door, and they will carry you out. Immediately she fell down at his feet and breathed her last. When the young men came in, they found her dead. They carried her out and buried her beside her husband. And great fear came upon the whole church and upon all who heard of these things. Amen. And we thank God for his word. Amen. We bless us the reading of his truth. Father, as we turn to your word now, your solemn word, give us ears to hear, minds to understand, and hearts to submit to its authority and to walk in your ways. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. A little while ago, someone said this: Do you think we need reminding of what it means to be a member of the congregation? So I want to take this opportunity today, as we will be welcoming new members into the congregation, about the promises that are taken at the Lord's table that we, if we are a member, we have all taken at some point in the past. And what it means to be a member of the Presbyterian Church in Ireland. We just read a passage where Ananias and Sapphira had stood in front of the church, in front of the church leadership, the apostles, and they had made promises. They had made promises. They had made a promise that they would sell their property and give the proceeds to the church. And they appeared in those early days. Appeared at the start of the chapter that's exactly what they were doing. They had gone and indeed sold the property for a certain amount of money. And then they'd gone back to the apostles and handed over the proceeds. But they didn't hand over the proceeds, and that was the problem. They deliberately deceived the church. They deliberately lied to the apostles. Because they knew that when they sold the property, they were going to keep some of the money for themselves. They were not going to keep their promise and hand it all over to the apostles. And we read that Peter said, "Have you sold them the proceeds for such and such?" "Yes, we did." Well, they lied. They weren't true to their word. They did not keep their promise. And we make promises throughout our life. Amy's just made promises for baptism. We make promises coming to the Lord's table. We make promises at our weddings. We make vows. We make promises in all sorts of walks of life. I mean, as I said, we make promises when we come to the Lord's table for the first time, seeking to be received into the full communicant membership of a congregation and all that that entails. And there are a couple of sets of questions. They've changed slightly, which you'll find out later on. They may not sound terribly familiar, but these are new ones that the church has set, but still carrying the same message. The first set of questions are really about your personal faith in God. Do you believe in God as your creator, as Jesus Christ, as your saviour, and as your Lord of your life? And do you believe in the Holy Spirit as the one who come and indwell within you and guide you and sanctify you to become more like Jesus? The second set of questions really contain promises. Promises that we make in our commitment to attend worship, to give to the church, to serve and participate in the life of the congregation. First promise we make there is to worship. If we were to look through the communicant's role, list the names of people who claim to be members of this congregation, and then have a wee glance around you. There's quite a significant difference. There are far more in the role than they'd be sitting here Sunday by Sunday. And yet each and every one person who is on that role stood at the front of this building, or maybe they came from a little congregation, and promised to be faithful at worship. To be promised to be faithful in attending week by week the corporate worship of God and listen to the preaching of his word. Now, I know there are situations where it can crop up where we just can't make it. There can be illness or bereavement or maybe you're in one of those jobs that requires you to do shift work and be on duty on a Sunday, or other emergencies can crop up and we just cannot physically make it. But on the whole, these are minor issues. These are minor issues. And for many who are on the roll but don't turn up, the reasons for their non-attendance is simply not acceptable. A bit tired, have a lie in. Can't be bothered. You know, nice day, let's hit the beach. Or some other trivial reason why they just can't be bothered to turn up. And you know, friends, in the grand scheme of things, it is not a huge time commitment to attend on a Sunday, week by week. I was going to say you're only here for about an hour, but it's a bit more than an hour. It depends on how much I rant and rave at you. But it's not a massive commitment. And we've made that promise to be faithful at attendance. And part of the promise is also to be faithful in the reading of God's word and the seeking of him in prayer. How faithful are we in reading God's word and spending time with him in prayer? Not just coming along on a Sunday and letting me do it all up here, but actually in the privacy of your own homes, in that secret place that Jesus talked about. And friends, we would know the Lord a whole lot better, we would walk with him a lot more faithful if we spent personal time in his word and in his presence in prayer. That includes church prayer meetings as well, when we gather to bring the needs of the congregation and the community to the Lord. But come along to corporate worship, to public worship, whatever you want to do it, reading God's word and studying it either together or in private, it's not just a tick box exercise. And I'm as guilty of it as well. There's days I've gone, there's the first thing of the day done, let's move on to the next. We can get into that mindset. We can simply slip into it. But coming along, it's not a sense of duty. It's not tick box exercise to salve our consciousness. Well, I've been there this week, that's grand. It coming here does not earn you favour with God simply because you've sat on the pew and you've thrown money in the plate and you've done other things. Coming here should be our heart's desire because we want to come to know God more as we study His Word together. And we should have it should be our heart's desire to come here and to praise God and to thank God and to bring glory to God for all that He has done and who He is. We should want to be here. We should be rushing every Sunday to come and to meet with the Lord and to bring Him glory. You know, sometimes we sing a little song by that Australian group, City Alight, and it says this: I want to know you, Jesus, my Lord, King of the heavens, King of my soul. I trade my treasures and all my rewards, Jesus, to know you, then know you more. Friends, is that the desire of our heart? That we commit ourselves enthusiastically, passionately, to public worship and to the private worship of God in our homes. Now, secondly, we promise to serve to give. The old promise, it's changed slightly by the General Assembly, but the old words were this: do you promise to give a fitting proportion of your time, talents, and money for the church's work in the world? What does it mean by a fitting proportion? The Old Testament in particular talks about tithes and offerings to God. And that's what it says. And there are many opportunities in a congregation that where we can give a fitting proportion of our time, talent, and treasure, just to be very alliterated. I'm not going to go down the list because we'd be here for ages. There are so many jobs to do. So many things happen unseen by the vast majority of us. But I want to simply ask you, are you playing your part? Are you playing your part? Are you giving a fitting proportion of your time, talent, and treasure to the work of God in this place? Here's a wee statistic. Hopefully it's oops, they go back one. There are a wee statistic. It's been around to go for years and it hasn't changed much. It says 20% of church members do 80% of the work. 20% of church members do 80% of the work. And we all say how busy the church is. So can you imagine how busy so few people are carrying this place, doing things? And friends, if we were to keep that promise to give a fitting proportion, it wouldn't be the same overworked view. I was going to say double jobbing, but they're more than double jobbing. Doing just about everything and becoming jaded and fed up and stressed as a result. And friends, every congregation needs help in so many ways. And it's not all up here, okay? The jobs are not all up front jobs. You don't have to say, oh, I can't stand up in front of people. There's so much needs done for the work of the gospel. And it's not all up front. A couple of examples. Lots of very practical, handy people around here. Grass cutting, 7 o'clock tomorrow night, Alec. Go and talk to him. It needs done. It's a practical thing. If nobody cut the grass, we'd be living in a jungle. What about keeping the buildings in order, tidy? John Hamilton looks after that. Can you spare an hour, a couple of hours every so often to come and share the responsibility of just keeping our property in shape so we can continue the gospel ministry? Minor repairs. Some things are very handy. Many repairs here are down at the manse. Things need done to maintain the church's property for gospel ministry. What about maybe more direct ministry, gospel work? We need creche helpers. We need children's people in children's church. We need people to help on a Sunday evening when we have jam. Holiday Bible Club is coming up in August, and we need help. If you can help in any of those, Claire, or Yvonne Beckett or myself, come and speak to us. Again, we're not going to put you up the front to necessarily do the teaching, but you can still help. We need people to help serve in this gospel ministry. What about the guys down the back? The sound desk and the computer. Stephen and Gareth have been carrying the workload by themselves for so long. Working the cameras, live streaming, recording and fixing the sound. And it's simply too much for one. It's nearly too much for two people, even. Talk to Colin Heron. sessions, ask Colin to be the go-to man for anybody who wants to know about the side and needs help. Computer, stuff for the screens. Noel and Becky do it. They're faithful every week. But more help would be appreciated, simply to go down and to flick the slides over. These are all things that help aid our worship and aid our gospel ministry, and they need help. And we had a great, well, I think it was a great session meeting last Monday night where we talked about new opportunities for when the hall is completed, new things we could potentially do to reach our community and to build the church. But you know, the one comment that came through clearly? To do this, we need people who are committed to serve. Committed to serve. I was down at the senior Sunday school this morning. One of the things I was saying to them, the fact is, when God calls us and brings us into his church, he has gifted each and every one of us to do things for him, to serve him, to do works of service, as Ephesians says, works of service that will bring glory and honor to him and build his kingdom. And we need people, we need lots of people, behind the scenes and up front. We can all play a part. So friends, what do you do? How do you serve? I know there are some of you here who go way over and above the sense of duty. You give so much time. But if others came on board, you could spread that load and we could all play our part. And we could all help. Fitting proportion of our time and our talents. Fitting proportion of our money. Now, if there's ever a sensitive issue to be talked about from a pulpit, it's money, isn't it? However, when it comes to sorting out our own personal finances, what we do is to set aside for God the first fruits. And if we were to give financially as the Bible instructs, then you know what? We wouldn't need to have coffee mornings and stuff like that there, because the money would be in the accounts. And the elders in the committee could then make decisions about what needs to be done for the gospel ministry. In this place, we'd be able to support ministries, we'd be able to support missionaries in the way that we really ought to do. And again, what is a fitting proportion? Well, I still believe that tithing is a valid biblical teaching because Jesus commanded it in the New Testament. But more importantly, Jesus made it very clear that our giving of our financial resources should be sacrificial. We all know the story in Luke chapter 21, don't we? Where Jesus was sitting in the temple courts and he looked up and there was all this rattling as the offerings were going in from the rich and the wealthy. And yet, the one he commanded was the poor widow who put in two little worthless coins. Why? Because she gave everything, whereas they were just given a proportion out of their vast wealth. Her giving should be sacrificial. And so the question I ask all of us, including myself, is do we give sacrificially? Do we go without some luxury? Something that's not really a necessity, but we just like the thought of having it, in order to give to God what is rightfully his, to lay up treasures in heaven, to support a work where we are trying to reach this village with the gospel of Christ and the hope of salvation. Are we giving a fitting proportion of our time, our talents, and our money? And finally, I'll not go on too much longer, we promise to participate fully in the church's life and witness. Or again, as the old vows used to say, do you promise, depending on the grace of God, to confess Christ openly, to serve him in your daily occupations, and to walk in his ways all the days of your life. And if we're honest, this is probably the hardest one to keep, isn't it, folks? Because taking a stand for Christ, to confess Christ in word and deed in our daily lives outside the security and the safety of a place like this is tough. It puts us in the firing line, and probably even more so now than it has done in the past. We will be criticized, we're out of touch, we're irrelevant, we're bigoted, we're narrow-minded, and sure, the list goes on how the church and Christians are lambasted these days. And so I understand, and as I've confessed from this pulpit before, when I was in the workplace, I kept my mouth shut and said nothing, because I just felt outnumbered. I didn't have the courage to do it. Friends, that's not just something for today. It happened in Scripture as well. The church has always been under fire for the message it proclaims. Even in New Testament times, even in these early days in the book of Acts that we were reading about. But imagine this. What if those first apostles had decided to stay in that upper room and keep the door locked and not obey the call of Christ to go into all the world and to take the good news about Jesus? What would have happened? But they didn't. They obeyed him. They gave their all to him. They put their lives on the line because he had given his life for them. Last Sunday night, we had a bit of a time of reflection in preparation for coming to the table this morning. We looked at Bible passages from the book of Matthew. We thought about what Christ had suffered physically and emotionally and all the rest of it. And we focused on how much he suffered on the cross for you and me. He gave everything, absolutely everything. He held nothing back. And friends, if we grasp that, how can we not give everything in return to him? As we were committed to that final promise to confess Christ and to serve him and to walk in his ways, what a significant impact we would have out there. We wouldn't just be seen as a bunch of people who drive in on a Sunday in our nice cars and our nice clothes and then drive out again. But we would be seen as a people who really believe what they teach, because they would see it in our daily lives. Our lifestyles would back up our confession. And people would be challenged by it. You know, when we deliberately stand in front of others and make promises, one day you're like, that used to be as a child, you know what I mean? Well, having fingers crossed behind my back, I didn't really mean it. Are we a bit like that? Do we have no intentions of keeping the promises or even attempting to keep them? We just do it at the front so we can get our name on a book, and then the church has to do things that we want. And friends, if we come with that attitude, then we're not only deceiving the people here who are watching us, but as Peter said to Ananias, you have not lied to men, but to God. You've lied to God. He knows what's in your heart. He knows what your intentions were. And for Ananias and Sapphira, the consequence of their dishonesty, of their lies, of their deception, was that the judgment of God came upon them immediately. When Peter said, you've lied to God, Ananias fell down and breathed his last. When Sapphira lied and said, yes, this is how much we've given, we read, immediately she fell down and breathed her last. The judgment of God was immediate on them because they lied to the Holy Spirit. They lied to God. And friends, we stand and we make promises. We make promises before God. And we deliberately fail to keep them. And we have no intentions of keeping them. Then, friends, here's a warning. His judgment will come upon us. Maybe not as dramatic as this. Well, one day we will stand before the throne of God and he will judge us for our dishonesty. Solemn thought. But it's in the scriptures and we need to be warned. But what I want to say is this. Mere fear should not be our motivation for keeping promises. We shouldn't keep our word because we don't want to go into the principal's office and get caned and punished. Our motivation should be something completely different. I recommended this book at our Easter teaching week, Essential Christianity by J.D. Greer, and it's essential reading. It's essential reading. Get into Faith Mission or online to the Good Book Company and buy it. Easy to read. Challenging to read. But this is what Greer says in his book. God loved us enough to become a man and lay down his life for us. When we spurned him, he sought us. When we forsook him, he forgave us. He's the God who not only created us, but redeemed us when no one else would have. Why wouldn't we want to offer our lives to him? Or as an old hymn that we sang last week said, "Were the whole realm of nature mine, not were an offering far too small. Love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life, my all." Friends, the Lord Jesus Christ gave absolutely everything to redeem us, to rescue us, to give us a new life, to give us hope. He shed his blood, his body was broken. How can we make promises that we have no intentions of keeping? How can we not give everything to him? You know, we do fail to keep promises. Listen, we're not perfect people. We will struggle in our battle against the old sinful nature. There will be times we say, "Oh, I'm not doing that. I'm not giving that up. No, I'm not sacrificing that. No, I want to do this here." But thankfully, we have a great God. And as our next hymn says, "Although our sins are many, his mercy is more." Let's stand and praise him with those wonderful words. Elders would like to come to the front and join me at this point. As they do so, they will lift the tokens to mark your attendance here at today's communion service. Thank you. One of the wonderful things in my job is to welcome people into the congregation. It's always a delight to see people coming and wanting to be part of the fellowship and the family in your church, and it's great to be able to do that. It was lovely, as you know, we were down home last week, and it was lovely to go and see so many new faces, people who come to faith, people who come to join the church and be part of the life there, and it was a great time. And today, we're going to welcome people into our family here in First Breshean. Now, I know we have a couple of transfers to acknowledge today, and there are some that we received papers for last year when I was off, so we never got a chance to publicly welcome them. So I'm going to embarrass you now. if you've come by transfer from another church, either giving me papers this year or it happened last year, can you please stand just in your seats? Just in your seats. Raya, you're down the back. Keith and Margaret's here. Julie, come on, stand up. Folks, you're very, very welcome, and this is just our public acknowledgement of you joining this family, and I know you've been around for quite a while, but we trust that as you settle into our family here in First Breshean, that you feel very much at home, and you find your place where you can come to worship and to serve. So you're very welcome indeed. The Lord bless you. That's all I'm going to do to you. No more embarrassment, but I won't do that. We're also delighted to welcome into our fellowship today some new people who are going to come on profession of faith and become full communicant members of the congregation. So I'm going to ask them to come forward now and squeeze into this gap here. So I'm going to ask Heather and Gaston to come up and also Amy and Alexander to come as well. And I'm going to squeeze around. There you go. Just shove them out of the way. These four folks have received instruction and what it means to be a church member. They've gone through the little booklet that our denomination produces and to be given out to those seeking communicant membership. They came along and met with the elders last Monday night over in the park room, and we were able to sit and chat with them and get to know them a little bit better, and the session agreed that we should come and welcome them into full communicant membership today around the Lord's table. And they're coming to make that public commitment to Christ and public commitment to this congregation as well. Why do we make these vows? Why do people make the vows when they become a member of the congregation? Well, the vows signify a commitment of you four to God and of his commitment to you. They are a statement of your belief in the one true God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and a commitment, as I've been preaching on, to serving him and his kingdom. And they're also a moment when a person publicly identifies as a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, and they confirm a person's membership of his church and in a local congregation that worships him. So I'm going to ask you a series of questions about your faith, your commitment to Christ and to his church. And the same as Amy, listen to the start of the question and you'll be fine. You two are fine. Nearly 50 years married, so you should know how to answer questions. You two, this is practice, Alexander. Okay, get it right now and you should be all right next summer. First question, in becoming a communant member of the congregation, do you believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? And depending on the grace of God, do you trust in Jesus Christ alone as your Saviour from sin and as Lord of your life? Do you promise to live as a follower of Jesus Christ, led and empowered by the Holy Spirit? And do you commit as a communicant member of this congregation to worship, serve, give, and participate fully in its life and witness? Let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you again for this wonderful sacrament that you have given to your church. Lord, it reminds us of all that Christ has done for us upon the cross. And this is our opportunity, Lord, not only to reflect, but to express our commitment to him, and to rejoice in the new life that we can receive through his shed blood. Thank you for your church, a family, your son's body, by our participation in it, we grow in Christ through the teaching of your word, through the fellowship with others around us, and to grow in our confidence and our boldness as we exercise the gifts that you have given to us in serving you. Father, thank you for these folks who are seeking in this public profession to become full members of this congregation here, your church on earth. Father, we pray that you will strengthen Heather and Gaston and Amy and Alexander. Fill them with your spirit. Fill them with wisdom. Fill them with a deep understanding of what it means to follow Jesus and to be part of his church. Fill them with that spirit of commitment and courage to serve in your church and to proclaim the gospel of Jesus in word and deed. And Father, draw near to them may they know your presence each and every day in a very real and powerful and tangible way that will enable them to walk faithfully with you. And Lord, to radiate your glory. I may ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Friends, as much as you made a profession of faith, I now, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, admit you to the fellowship of the Lord's table. And as a token of such, I extend the right hand of fellowship. And we've got a little gift for you to share, one gift for each couple. A couple of little books for you. One is a devotional book. It's by Alistair Begg. It's volume 2. It's absolutely amazing. It's been such a blessing to anybody who has it. And use it. And indeed, as you spend time with the Lord every day, use it. Another wee book is called Belong. I recommend it to the whole congregation. Sorry, Noel. Little book, Belong. What does it mean to belong to Christ and belong to his church? That's, again, along with Essential Christianity, that's an essential book. I hope it helps you understand what it means to be part of the family of God. Thank you very much, and you're very welcome to the congregation. Please take a seat as we approach the Lord's table. And this table has been prepared by the Lord Jesus Christ for all who trust in him. And so, friends, if you are sorry for your sins, if you have confessed them to Christ, and you sincerely commit your life to following in his ways as your Savior and Lord, you're welcome. You're welcome to come to this table. And you're invited to come, not because we say so, but because the Lord Jesus invites you. You're invited to come and to taste and see that the Lord is good, because blessed is the one who takes refuge in him. We come not because we ought, but because we may. Not because we are righteous, but because we are penitent. Not because we are strong, but because we are weak. Not because we are whole, but because we are broken. And so as we come to the table, we turn to God's word. John's going to read it for us in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, the words of institution. Thank you, John.
First Corinthians 11, verse 23 to 29. For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself."
Thank you, John. Let's bow in prayer together. We bow before you, the eternal and creator God. And we bow before you with thankfulness. It is good and it is right that we do give you thanks, because you are God. You're holy, you're strong, you're loving, you're faithful. And you have made us, each and every one of us here, Lord, in the most unique way. And we are the most special part of your whole vast, magnificent creation. Because when you made us to have a personal relationship with you and to have dominion over all that you have made. And we come with thankfulness, Lord, because we have not grasped the privilege of that relationship. We have turned away from you. We have rejected you. And yet we are grateful because you did not abandon us. You did not wipe us off the face of the earth and start afresh. But Lord, out of the depths of your immeasurable love and your steadfast faithfulness, you gave all that you had. You gave Jesus, your only Son, who came to this earth, who showed us what it means to walk in obedience to you. And then more amazingly, he willingly laid down his life upon the cross and suffered the punishment, the judgment on our behalf. And through faith, through trust and repentance in him, Lord, we can receive his righteousness, his perfection, and be adopted as your sons and daughters. Lord, on the night before he was betrayed by one closest to him, your son shared a meal with friends. A meal that cast their minds back to when their forefathers were set free from captivity, but a meal that would carry greater significance, that would remind us of the ultimate price that was paid to set us free from the slavery of sin and eternal judgment. So, Father, as we gather at this table, as we take this bread and this wine, we remember that meal. And we celebrate Christ's love, his life, his death, and his resurrection. And Father, as we feast upon this bread and wine, we plead, Lord, that you would send your Holy Spirit upon us to feed our souls, to strengthen our souls, to renew our souls, to transform us, to become more and more like your perfect Son, Jesus, and reflect your glory. So, Father, as we gather, as we partake in your mercy and your grace, we plead that you would come and meet with us in a very real way. We would be overpowered by your Holy Spirit. We would be a broken and humble people, but we would also be a restored and hopeful people because of your Son. And this we pray in his precious name. Amen. Now, according to the Holy Institution, example and command of our Lord Jesus Christ, and as a memorial for him, we do this. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." And after the same manner also, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." So take and eat. This is the body of Christ, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of him.
Lamb of God,
This is the body of Christ. Do this in remembrance of him. New covenant sealed by Christ's blood, which was shed that the sins of many might be forgiven. Drink from it, all of you.
My Jesus.
This cup is the new covenant sealed by Christ's blood. Do this in remembrance of him. As we prepare to rise from this table, leaving behind these visible reminders of that incredible sacrifice that was made for our redemption, give us the strength, the courage, that what we have said with our lips we may believe in our hearts, and that what we believe in our hearts we may practice in our lives for your glory and your honour, and your praise. And we offer ourselves to you in Christ's name. Amen. Friends, at this table we have beheld the Lamb who was slain for us. We have shared in this bread, the bread of life. And we have drunk this wine, the wine of his sacrifice. We have remembered the promise that all who come in faith to Christ will find forgiveness at the cross. And so now, as we come to rise and to leave, we come with thankfulness and we come with faith. Let us rise and respond to all that he has done for us. Let us remember our call to follow in the steps of Christ and to proclaim the truth that Christ will come again. Let us stand and sing, "Behold the Lamb."
We remember.
And now may the blessing of God, the giver of every good and perfect gift,